say, brother, help me please. But he winds up knocking me back down on my knees. Lord, there have been times that I thought I couldn't last for long. But now I think I'm able to carry.
Well, Vicky Moore, it's been 82 days now, 82 days and counting, since a four-month-old child was killed in the middle of I-10, surrounded by law enforcement. Killed in a state that right now is challenging abortion. Four-month-old baby dead, infanticide, and we cannot determine in 82 days who shot that child. I'll get to that ridiculousness in just a few minutes. But it just insults my intelligence beyond belief. The holy in thou. I want you to play that, bro. That infamous moment that now we cannot determine. That moment when a getaway car was traveling around 5 miles per hour, then there's a spin-out procedure done, and that car ends up in the median, surrounded by well over 50 law enforcement, lined up like a parade, representing all the agencies literally in this area. Even some of Louisiana was there, but they didn't fire a shot. Biloxi didn't fire a shot. 34 shots ended up in that vehicle. You can very faintly hear the baby's cry after that last shot, and you hear the sirens. Some of you can't hear it, but if you listen just a little closer, trust me, you can. Don't talk to me about how much you love children and something like this happened. They knew that child was in the car. Living, breathing, four-month-old baby. There was no car seat. Baby was next to his, well, father, I'll use that term loosely, according to troopers that I chatted with in Louisiana. Chief of Police in Baton Rouge said he wouldn't dare fire a shot because of the hostage child. So that 2.5 hour trip down 12 and ultimately to I-10 ended in this state, this very same state that now feels it is going to protect the so-called unborn, and you could not protect the born? This is what, ladies and gentlemen, makes all of us look horrible. This holier-than-thou conservative mindset, but yet, you know what I mean? They will determine. Con stands for control, and that's exactly what is happening here now. So the last word we got from the Biloxi PD, who's investigating this, is that, well, they just got to wait on all the other agencies to provide information. 82 days and they don't have it. There's nobody to chase here. There's no other culprits. There's no other... What is the evidence? Well, all the evidence is in the hands of law enforcement. So what? Not one time did I hear, sorry it happened. Not one time did I hear that. And I'm going to tell you something. Every man, especially every woman who's in uniform right now, would be ashamed of themselves, including the Biloxi PD. Everybody there should have said, man. At the very least, there's nothing wrong saying sorry. Well, we don't just say we're sorry to you. You represent us. Excuse me. You represent us. Well, it was the dad's fault, blah, 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 blah. Okay. You think that lets you off the hook? Did the dad shoot the baby? Well, if that is the case, show that. I do know one thing. Those shots that were plucking off the windshield didn't come from dad. I'm sorry, I use that term loosely. Father, that loosely too. There are standards, and everybody knows that they didn't follow the standards, folks. Everybody did, and I don't doubt that probably some of the men, or hopefully some of the men who participated in that, whether their bullet ended up in little LaMelo or not, has got to feel a certain kind of remorse. But then there are some individuals who really just kind of chop this up. You know who you are, those individuals who don't see all people as people, you know, those who can't handle multiculturalism. After all, they're not like us. You know who you are. And I don't know whether you fired a shot or not. So this is not for you, because I realize what you represent. But the rest of us, decent, law-abiding, honest, forgiving, loving, human beings, Christians, Hindu, Jewish, whoever, Catholics, atheists, who believe in live and let live, see this completely different. And don't sit up and preach to me about Roe v. Wade if you can't see this as the same. This baby did not take his own life. So how many months is reasonable for you? I've got to remind me to talk about the Moors, wouldn't you? But I've got to stay here because once again, Mississippi, we've done it again. I don't know what's with these folks. Well, I do know what's with them. The arrogance born out of ignorance. My God, can we once and for all get rid of this conservative mindset? It is just... I mean, ladies and gentlemen, it's just said, you wear it like a badge of honor, and you guys have got to see through this charade. On the one hand, they talk about, okay, holier than thou, and on the other hand, they're stealing from you. On the one hand, they talk about, let's just get along. On the other hand, they're sowing seeds of discontent between people. Let's see, it is the Negroes, it is the whites, it is the LGBT. It's always something. There's always something with this bunch showing the difference in you and I as Mississippians. We can't just all just be different and be Mississippians. We got to be a black one. We got to be a white one. And by the way, that is by design. When you listen to the Dog Network, trust me on this. That is by design. It goes all the way back, ladies and gentlemen, to how the seeds of discontent were sowed in 1619. It's actually coming from the British playbook. All you got to do is convince one group that they have privileges that the other group doesn't. And tell that group, here's the reason for those privileges that they have, because that group there will try to take those from you. They're coming for your children, they're coming for your guns, that kind of diatribe, and it's just stupid. This country's not black and white. All Negroes are not poor, all Caucasians are not rich. The average Joe out here is not even once, not even a little bit fazed by discussing race. But every time, that average Joe is always confronted with some bigot, reminding him of it. Damn, now I gotta deal with this. Man, I just come on my job trying to just... I was thinking of just trying to get my boy in college, and now I gotta deal with some guy who just feels that he gotta tell me a nigger joke. I gotta now figure out how I can just maintain this and keep from whooping his ass. Oh God, I'm going to get high blood pressure, hypertension, I mean, I got, it's enough that I come here, I do an excellent job, but now I gotta hear that. Now I gotta have him, I gotta laugh at his jokes now. If I don't, you realize, of course, needless to say, I'm gonna be fired because after all, I seem like I'm a little angry. Oh, Rip don't laugh at our jokes anymore. Or, if Rip allows it, you know, Rip's all right. We can say what we want around him and he doesn't get upset. You wanna know what it's like being an African-American male, a strong African-American male? Let me tell you what that's like. That's like pretending that somehow or another, someone who you know is not as smart as you or strong as you, but because they have the power of the pen or the gold, you have to say to yourself, I'm gonna let him get away with it. Oh, you gotta understand, I gotta allow him to slap me because I wanna feed my babies. Oh, does that sound extreme? I'm telling you, this is not Jim Crow. We're not talking during Mega Edwards, Mississippi. We're talking about right now, there are people who are listening to me on the job, shaking their head going, yeah, you're right. I gotta tolerate you. I don't dislike you. Why I gotta tolerate your insecurities, your impotence? Can't I just be a man? And if I'm better than you, get the hell out of the way. Yeah, I want your job. Must it always be now I've gotta humble down? I gotta now. I want you to pull up what the sergeant said, you know, when he was asking on 60 Minutes, bro. Well, they were asking him what it was like in the United States military, whereby, you know, here he is, he's been having this. Now listen to me, like, this is not race, it's this big. You guys, look, Caucasian listeners, you guys have got to isolate these people. You got to call this out now. I don't mean you got to confront them, because I know you're scared. I know you just want to get out of the way. I had one individual, very esteemed individual, knew that this person who was in the same group was just being a stone cold bigot and doing the wrong thing. And I said to him, I said, look, man, you know this. You're a lawyer, you know, you're around legal. You know this isn't right. So if I can tell you, you're right. You're absolutely right. You're right, but I got to live here. I'm so sick and tired of weak-kneed white boys telling me that, end quote.
I got to live here. I mean, you know, I understand, and you're absolutely right. He's very wrong, but I just can't take this. I can't take this case. I got to live here. I gotta feed my family like you gotta feed yours, and I don't want
to. I'm not angry. I'm not angry in the least. I'm just describing it. If it makes you feel uncomfortable, then maybe I'm talking about you. That's fine. The only significance that we have with one another, black, white, brown, indifferent, or undecided, the only significance that we have with each other is that we're here. You're breathing the same air. In some cases, pursuing the same happiness. And if so, and I beat you to it, don't try to tell me that somehow or another I don't deserve it, or change the rule. You know, don't get me wrong, you were given a leg up. There's no doubt about that. There is skin privilege. Now, if you want to ignore that,
or my parents didn't have slaves, well, guess what? They were protected by laws that protected whites like your parents.
When they got off that boat coming from Portugal, guess what? The most important thing they had was that little thin sheave of camouflage.
They said they were white, see?
Whether you like that or not, it's irrelevant. That's not critical race theory. That's just the truth. I mean, prime example, critical race theory is just the signs that was right there at the Greyhound bus station in Biloxi or Gulfport. I mean, it's still got the water fountain there at the courthouse. Oh, Harrison County. So here we are again. Mississippi challenges Roe v. Wade. Why does it have to be Mississippi?
Well, you know.
No, I don't know. Oh, God.
Well, you know.
Oh, God.
I mean, do you not know, really? You know why.
Where do you get these seersucker suits from? I don't... Well, I mean, they don't even... Nobody wears seersucker suits. You look like something out of Gone with the Wind or...
Thank you.
I see your damn hat. What is that? What is that? What is that? Cat on the hot tin roof?
That's right. You like it, don't you?
No, I don't like it. Actually.
I'll show you where I got it from.
I don't want to know where you got it from, but I just want to know why it is.
You don't want to say on the radio, but you do.
Why do you have to put Mississippi in this light is my question.
Why wouldn't Mississippi want to be put in the light is my question in retort, sir?
Because
Mississippi has to stand for something. Mississippi has to stand for moral high ground, deeply held moral conviction, religious. We're the most religious state in this nation.
And you realize there were more churches burned in this state than any other state?
That's right. And probably more crosses as well.
Well, I guess that is a symbol of your religiosity.
I mean, that should be part and parcel of what we represent here. Come on. So let me get this straight now, just to make sure all my folks in McHenry know what's going on this morning on It's a
Nickname. I'm glad to know where you're from.
Right over. Anyway, right off 49. Anyway, so is it my understanding?
I'm not looking at you.
Is it my understanding that you don't, excuse me, there you go. Is it my understanding that you don't agree with what Lynn Fitch is doing for us? Not just for us in this state, but for the nation.
Yes, you got that right. No, I completely disagree with what she's doing, Lynn Fitch, because I don't know where Mississippi, where we as constituents have said, hey, Lynn Fitch, let's go in and get rid of Roe v. Wade. Where did that initiative come from? That who put forward that on the ballot?
Well, I mean, you know, we're talking about, you know, banning abortions at 15 weeks and whatnot here in this state. It's just a hop, skip, and a jump over to the 1973 decision. So it is my understanding, okay, that what Lynn Fitch is trying to do here is bring us all back around to the moral high ground and putting this back in front of the people, okay?
So let me ask you, you realize a woman is a people. She's part of
a woman is a people.
Yeah, and you do understand that this is about unreasonable searches and seizures, Roe v. Wade.
You know, I hear that all the time.
That's what it says here. In other words, okay, I'll tell you what, then are you going to be the one to check to see whether a man's wife, a girlfriend, or his daughter is pregnant?
Well, I'm not a doctor, Rip. I'm not a doctor. Okay.
So when does the government come in? The government comes in, is she privileged to her own medical records, or when does the government come in?
Well, I think that, you know, when she's going in to have an abortion, right, she's kind of giving up that right, isn't she? Because she's opening up herself for the examination to confirm that she's pregnant in order to get the abortion.
So when you go to the doctor to check your private parts or what have you, is that a litmus test? Do you think that people should be able to ask you whether or not you suffer from penis envy or something like that?
Well, I don't know what that's got to do with anything.
Well, I mean, in other words, it's you, as your private person. I mean, this is between you and your doctor, isn't it?
Well, I mean, I don't even think that's between me and my doctor. Ain't none of his business either. You know, I mean, unless I'm going for some kind of enlargement treatment or procedure or something like that. But even then, that's what I'm saying. If I'm going in to get a couple extra inches, right, and then I'm, you know, I'm putting myself out there like that. So
that's subject to the government saying, okay, well, wait, how many inches are you going to add to adenectomy? Is that what it's called?
I think that's something like that. I'll look up the scientific term here. But, you know, it's like I'm going in there. He's going to see where I'm working with already, like he's my doctor. He's going to see what I'm working with.
I'm asking you, when does
you
the...
You ask me.
When does does the government check you when you're going between you and your...
When I go
when you go, then we should all... The,
so we should stop us from going there, at least us women, the, y'all women.
What I'm asking you is, so if you're agreeing that the government should then be able to determine with what you're doing with your doctor...
Right. And, yes. Pretty sure.
So which agency would you like to go prying, poking and prying into your medical records?
Well, I mean, that's the thing.
And checking to make sure that you did get the inches or...
I don't understand this argument. Who's going to go do that anyway?
Well, you must understand that there is an evaluation to determine whether or not a woman is pregnant and then how many
right.
months.
Right, but does not...
And where must she report that to the doctor?
Does not she put herself in the position to be examined to determine...
No. But by her doctor. This is oversight by government. At what point does government say, let me see? You want to see, don't you?
Kind of. I just want to know what it looks like.
Will you take the damn suit off and the hat, Ro? This is a serious conversation here. So here we are. Once again, bright spotlights on Mississippi of all the places, the poorest state in the union, the state with the largest, the greatest per capita infant mortality. Not only that, the mother mortality, whatever. That's when you realize women die in childbirth. And there are more women dying in this state than any other state. We did a show on this, bro. Remember, we had the, what are they called now? The women, the midwives?
Doulas, yeah.
Doulas or something like that. And I was horrified. We're next to some third world countries because of our access, our women's access to doctors and pediatricians and gynecologists all over this state. There are people, women dying.
A lot.
The greatest infant mortality, right here. Right here. And we want to be holier than thou? We have the fewest people per capita insured and access to a pediatrician. Lynn Fitch, in her Southern Belle garb, jumps out here with this. Look, it's an argument, family. Why Mississippi got to lead this charge? Damn, we just got too much. We just took the battle flag off our flag. Come on. Once again, you want to put us in this spotlight? Do you think that everybody's going to be holier than thou? This is not about abortion, ladies and gentlemen. This is about unreasonable searches and seizures, and I guarantee you the Supreme Court's going to rule the same way. They don't have a choice. Just tell me. They don't have a choice. As much as I love children, as much as I'd like to be able to tell my woman, that she gonna have that baby, it is her choice. It's her choice. If she doesn't feel that I am honorable enough to give me that privilege and feel that I'm worthy to have the privilege of a child by her, then guess what? She'll decide. What this is about is basically Caucasian male arrogance, to be quite frank. They realize their numbers are dwindling, and so now, just because of the white nationalists, they want to try to save it. Those abortion credit cards that they were using back when Caucasian women were having 5 and 6 and 12 children. They came in handy when, the side piece got it. But the reality here now is, oh boy, we're doing big numbers now. That combined with the fact of impotence. Be not misled, that's what this is about. They'll try to tell you, this is about, going back to eugenics, and you know, they were Negroes, they were trying to sterilize. And they'd be accurate. They certainly were trying to sterilize a Negro, just ask Fannie Lou Hamer. That's what happened to her there in the Delta. That's why she was a male doctor. They were all male doctors. They were. You guys, let me tell you something. I am not going to forget what I know to make you feel good about yourself, and that's why you got this big pushback from conservatives. About everything from critical race theory to abolition, whatever. I'm going to get into it in a minute. But they'll pull up these little things just to try to show an example of some extreme. The same old playbook that the Klan was using, the same old playbook segregationists was using. They get the gullible whipped up thinking that somehow or another Rip Daniels is
forcing his will upon them.
When the truth is that they're just manipulating you to think that somehow or another we're that separated, that different. But let's go into this. You know, the Constitution does say who is a citizen of these great United States. And ladies and gentlemen, I'm here to tell you, it never once mentions the unborn. I know you'd like for it to do, and I'm with you. Go ahead and make an amendment with it. And that's what it's going to take, by the way. But the 14th Amendment spells it out very, very clearly. Bro, I mean, you have it over there. It's, all persons born are naturalized. Now, if you're not born, then you are not recognized, whether you like it or not. This is what the Roe v. Wade, a Supreme Court, had to deal with. All persons born or naturalized in the United States and subject to the jurisdiction thereof are citizens of the United States. Born. Says it. Underscore. Now change it.
Amend it.
However, once you do that, then you've got to say, well, okay, there is a person born. That is the, that is the mother. That's the mother. So she is certainly born, and she's naturalized and are naturalized here in these United States. And therefore, she's a citizen. So she's protected by the laws, and from the laws. Says it right here. No state shall make or enforce any law which shall abridge the privileges or immunities of citizens of the United States. For shall any state, nor shall any state deprive any person of life, liberty, or property without due process of law, nor deny to any person within this jurisdiction the equal protection of the law against unreasonable searches and seizures. That's what Roe v. Wade was. The problem that the courts had was, well, okay, so, how do we know? They did come up with a caveat, and that was, okay, we'll take it to the third trimester. That's, 6 months. There's viability of the fetus. I don't know why they know it's all science. So they restricted a woman from having a procedure unless it's a matter of her life. Who determines that? Well, let's see. Her doctor and her. So when does the court come into the obstetric room? When does the guy in his silk sucker suit come in with the gloves on? Let me check. Are you sure she's gonna die? Doesn't look like it to me. This is the problem that the courts have. At what point does the mother give up her right to have the government peer into her vagina? Check her womb. Do you know that when a woman gets pregnant, it's not an exact science? Did you know that? You realize this is a guess? Oh, don't talk to a woman. Well, when did she get pregnant? Oh, when did she stop her cycle? I'm so weird. They don't know. We don't really know exactly, because after all, we don't check. So when does the government first check to determine whether or not she's pregnant? How do you know it's not just a gallbladder or fibroids? There are women who don't even know they're pregnant, bro. See, the problem I have with this is the privacy thing. I'm going to jump into no conclusion. Oh, yeah, well, I just want to kill babies. No, I want to find out at what point do you want someone to check your woman? Because that's what's got to happen. That's what's got to happen. You can ban it all you want. You can say, oh, yeah, you know, because I came along, ladies and gentlemen, when you did not have Roe v. Wade, when actually there were women who were impregnated and who were having midwives and having abortions. As quiet as it was kept, some did it themselves with a coat hanger, unfortunately. Their bodies. You cannot control women this way. The conservative concept, the conservative patriarchal concept is exactly that. Con always stands for control. Of the peasants. So here we are, Mississippi, now on the front pages, and now we've got everybody, all eyes on us. All eyes on us, and so now we're gonna argue. What is the argument? The argument is, well, a woman, we've got to ban abortions by 15 weeks instead of the 28 weeks. Why? Because now there's new science to show that the fetus is, well, it's not viable, but it's a fetus. Okay. All right, so how are you going to determine that now? So what, you're going to peer into the doctors? How do you measure this? Well, what we're going to do is restrict doctors from doing anything like that. Okay, so I want you to, who's breaking this law? You're going to charge a woman who's pregnant? You want to charge a doctor? And so now, if in fact the father is estranged or not, and that could be her father, so he could actually say, no, I want her to have my baby. She's my daughter and she should have my baby. She's not good enough for me. She ain't good enough for nobody. I think she's pregnant. Go check her. Uncle Sam. You see how ridiculous this is?
Yeah.
That's the problem we have here. She is entitled to this. Her person. What weak men don't want is for her to have that decision. Now, if you want to argue the point and prove to me you're not weak, come. I'm ready. But don't talk to me about the baby. No, just talk to me about the woman. Because it is up to her whether you like it or not. Whether you like it or not. She can bite her tongue, bleed to death. She can eat glass. And here we are trying to torment them at a tender time like this? That is not how you win the favor. That is not how you convince any woman to go through with her pregnancy, which more in many cases she'd want, except if it's incest or rape. By the way, there's no exception to that in the Mississippi bill.
Nope.
Only in Mississippi. What kind of yahoos do we have up there? Lynn Fitch, I can't wait to vote against you. And everybody else up there with that holier-than-thou kind of attitude who want to deprive the rest of us of our rights. On the one hand, they protect rights. Oh, we don't want to have, we can't have the masks. We're not going to mandate masks and vaccines, but I can tell you one thing. We're going to mandate that this won't allow us to check her. Make sure she hadn't gone over the 15 weeks.
That's right.
We'll be back.
If you can't come to them, they'll come to you. Memorial Physician Clinic offer a Memorial Connect Now virtual visit to meet your health care needs. You never know when you need to speak to a medical professional. Fast. And they
what's going on, Gary?
Can't believe you, Rogue.
Y'all keep watching.
Why didn't you wear the damn suit?
That's
you should have worn it. Why you wearing a suit? You
wear the suit.
Real time.
Had my clothes on.
Anyway, Monday through Friday, 8 to 8.
Can you get that?
Y'all stay tuned. Give us a call. Talking about abortion 228.
And don't forget that you've got it on the app. You got the app. You
download the new app. The app that you have. If you haven't downloaded the new one, it's expiring today. Go to your app store. Thank y'all.
It's Memorial Connect Now virtual visit. Speak to a.